这个地方充满了无法捉摸的危险以及不可思议的美。这是一个神秘的沼泽，名叫奥克弗诺基，此地正是短吻鳄的王国。奥克弗诺基一度被视为人类的禁地，充满了致命的疾病，庇护着逃犯，滋养着恐惧与迷信。今天奥克弗诺基沼泽已成为众所皆知的野生动物避难所，但即使是对约翰·巴林博士这样的生物学家兼摄影专家来说，这个地方也未必欢迎他的到访。
Whenever I go back to Okefenokee now, I've got mixed feelings about it. From the air, when you go across it, it looks just so beautiful and so serene and so natural and so appealing, and yet it can be a place of such contrasts.That it seems almost as if man was never intended to be there for long.
奥克弗诺基沼泽区是个面积438,000英亩的天然洼地，由许多的岛屿、森林、湿地和开阔水源组合而成。这个地方之所以出名，除了因为盛产鳄鱼，还有这也是连载漫画里袋鼠波哥的家乡。奥克弗诺基沼泽区有小部分伸进了佛罗里达州的州界，但大部分仍在乔治亚州的东南角上。奥克弗诺基的塞米诺尔族印第安人在1830年代被驱逐出境后，由所谓沼泽族的白人拓荒者侵入并占领了此地。到1930年代的时候，沼泽族已安居在奥克弗诺基沼泽区，他们还出示鳄鱼巢和鳄鱼蛋给到访的摄影者看。这群沼泽族完全与外隔绝，其中大部分的人对沼泽外的世界既不需要也没兴趣。知道沼泽族的人莫不心羡他们的单纯质朴与自给自足。本世纪之初，沼泽区内天然的柏树林引起人们觊觎，大举侵入，有伐木活动，有造船穿越沼泽区，也有干脆将沼泽区的积水放干的，这一切都严重残害了奥克弗诺基。奥克弗诺基沼泽区的原始林在短短的20年内砍伐殆尽，很快的，这个沼泽区又只剩下沼泽族的人了。1937年，奥克弗诺基沼泽区正式成为国家级野生动物保留区，此地居民只得相继离去。一位先民曾如是说道：“我们能够保存这个沼泽区的确很不错，可惜沼泽族的人全走了，可惜我们不能同时保有两者。”伐木活动停止了50多年后的今天，仍可以找到许多伐木小屋的遗迹，静悄悄坐落于重新长成的林荫深处，成为肯特·菲利特和约翰·巴林这些生物学家目光的焦点。
This is an old crane.
Oh, this is.
The engine was up front,
在此地工作数季以后，巴林这位在英格兰长大的专家对这个乔治亚州的沼泽区也已十分熟悉了。
And there's something even more dramatic over here. Come have a guess at this. What do you make of this?
That's some sort of a chassis.
Right.
Is that what they carried the logs on?
Nope. Try again. Don't forget, we're on an island in the middle of Okefenokee, so try again.
Yeah. Some sort of a swamp buggy or something.
What is that? It's a car. They had three cars on the island.
Really? But that's a heavy...
heavy duty, isn't it?
Heavy chassis.
But look how well the metal's been preserved.
Yeah.
And there's another thing to pick out, too. You see why it's so good? It's British. Right-hand drive. It's a Durant car that they brought over on the trains for three people. Yeah, there were three cars that would chug up and down. And this thing is preserved so well. Many cars that are 10 years old don't have a chassis.
No. Well, that's a very heavy chassis.
Right. And it was just to take people up and down. There was a big turpentine still at the end of the island, too. And there was a cinema. There was a barber shop. All gone now.
It's amazing.
Yep.
Hardly a trace.
When the logging company finished up business, they just tried to get all the people off. When the National Parks Fish and Wildlife took it, 1937.
奥克弗诺基沼泽区内有些地方虽然可以徒步通行，但要在此地勘察，最好还是使用船比较方便。奥克弗诺基的水域是发亮的黑檀色，深邃，反射效果极佳，就像无数面小镜子晃荡在水面，魅力十足，恍如梦境。肯特·菲利特来自佛罗里达大学，他研究的是奥克弗诺基沼泽区内赫赫有名的定居者短吻鳄。
Do you know there's one right in front of us, Joe?
Yeah, I can see that one.
Mm-hmm. 对于喜欢追根究底的生物学家来说，能发出特殊的声音召唤鳄鱼群价值无穷。
It's coming. Oh, hey. Do they have binocular vision? Can they see three dimensions?
Only a little small fraction of their total visual field, just in front of their nose, is
binocular. Wait, is he coming too close?
No, he's fine.
Wow. Why do they have the yellow ring around their eyes? Is there a function that's known for that?
A number of aquatic animals have a coloration around the eye like that. Hippopotamuses do. It might have something to do with magnifying light going into the eye, sort of the reverse of a football player putting black grease under the eye.
To make them see better, in fact. It's going to go down?
Oh, there he goes.
How long will they stay underwater?
They can stay under a good long time. You know, when they're resting in the afternoon, they go down for at least 15 minutes.
Right. He's up again. Look.
Yeah, there it is. In the wintertime, they may stay down for days. Nobody knows.
For days and days? I mean, they're really, what, they hibernate?
Well, yeah, in the sense it is a hibernation. Their metabolism slows down so much when they're that cold that they just require almost no oxygen.
And they don't eat, obviously, if they...
No. They don't eat for several months during the winter.
I think the average member of the public that comes to Okefenokee and sees an alligator thinks they've really arrived in prehistory.
And back into the age of the reptiles.
Kent 研究鳄鱼的社会行为已经许多年了。在位于佛罗里达州甘尼斯市的实验当中，他正埋首分析搜集来的丰富资料。
We've learned that alligator behavior is actually very, very complex. It's much more complex and much more sophisticated than the behavior of other reptiles that have been studied. And so our dealings with alligator behavior have been to try to document the types of behaviors they show and analyze these, not only in simple terms of alligator behavior, but as they might represent the primitive beginnings from which the more complex behaviors of birds and mammals have evolved.
Kent 大部分的观察工作是在圣奥古斯丁鳄鱼养殖场内进行的， 数百只鳄鱼在此展出以吸引游客。这个养殖场让游客有机会接近这种深居简出的动物。
Are there many differences between these gator farm alligators and the ones you get in the wild?
No, captive animals look a lot different from wild animals. The most noticeable difference is that the head of a captive animal is much broader, that you don't have this beautiful elongated snout. That's because captive animals spend so much time on land basking. And at least in old animals like these, the head weighs so much that it just tends to flatten itself out over the years. It spreads out.Becomes much broader.
Is that what also squeezes the teeth out too? Because they're all showing.
Yeah,
very obvious
here. They're very toothy animals. Also, all the scales on their back are worn down, much more so than a wild animal would be. And that's just because these animals live in very high densities on farms and they crawl over each other and just kind of buff each other down all the time.
自1981年起，肯特在每年的四月到六月，当鳄鱼进入生殖季时，都详尽研究鳄鱼。但是肯特对自己早先已有利的位置调查并不满意，那样纵然比较安全，却无法有水面的精确视野。于是他决定潜入湖里，这样做当然不无几分冒险。
It is possible when you're in the lake that a big male will decide he doesn't want you there.And actually come up and try to get you out of his territory. We've had very few problems when I was swimming in the lake, but there's always the potential for an alligator getting a hold of you and doing some real damage.
肯特发现养殖场里的鳄鱼危险性相当的低，尤其在交配季的时候。根据这个观点，他设计一个极有价值的测试。
We learned early on in our research that we needed to get off the boardwalks and go down and look at alligators at an alligator's eye level. Alligators communicate to each other visually by the way they hold their bodies out of the water. And we got down into the water to better understand how alligators are talking to each other in a visual sense.
肯特对于这样浮游于鳄鱼之间与鳄鱼眼对眼觉得十分有趣，但这是因为他能了解鳄鱼的肢体语言，所以才能在各种危险出现前就摆脱危险。
I look for animals that are obviously directing themselves toward me as aggressive animals. The way they tilt their head, how high they hold their body out of the water are all indications if they're being aggressive or not. Not all the animals that come toward me are aggressive. Many are curious, but I still have to treat them all about the same. I can't let them get too close to me. I carry a large, about 5 foot long cypress pole with me, and if an animal does get too close, I just nudge it away and try to keep it out of strike range.
鳄鱼张嘴打哈欠这一行为的含义至今不明，也许毫无意义。至于像现在这种用头部拍水的动作，倒已解析出其中的意义。鳄鱼这一特殊的姿势主要是宣告自己的社会地位。到了求偶季节，鳄鱼群几乎每日都齐声吼叫，无论雌或雄都会吼叫，只是吼声有些许的差异。雄鳄鱼在开始求偶吼叫以前， 会先发出一个低音的讯号，这种讯号会把身旁的水波激得舞动起来。在野外，类似的讯息能够吸引到很远的雌鳄鱼。求偶活动是一连串优美、奇妙而且安静的过程，肯特有时能在很近的距离内亲眼目睹。
Courtship is usually initiated by one animal swimming slowly up to another, and this is a very important stage of courtship because they have to communicate to each animal that they have non-aggressive intentions. And secondly, they go into a period of touching one another along the face and neck, and they really orient each other.To each other's head and neck. In the third phase of courtship, these touching behaviors become more exaggerated and the animals start pressing each other down underwater. And these are real tests of strength between the two animals. And these will be accentuated until one animal is capable of pressing the other underwater and ultimately circle around and mount on that animal.And begin riding it around and ultimately roll over to one side and attempt to mate with that animal.
Alkafunoji 沼泽区鳄鱼繁殖相当成功，自无庸讳言。但是1970年代以前，鳄鱼一直惨遭偷猎。如今幸好有严格的法令保护此地的鳄鱼族群，其数量也已经增加到12000只左右。夏季沼泽中气体所造成的泡沫此起彼落，像极了奥克弗诺基的心跳。黑丝湖水下面有一层厚厚的泥煤，那是分解的植物所构成的。分解过程中产生的气体常常将大块的泥煤推出底层浮出水面，早期人称之为爆炸。经过一段时间，这些浮现的泥煤上又覆满了植物，有些再度沉下去，有些变成浮岛，渐渐长出了灌木丛，甚至还有树木。最后等树木的根长稳了，一块新的土地余烟诞生。这种由树林架构的小岛在当地称作屋子。奥克弗诺基是印第安文，意思是颤动之地。巴林博士上了一个幼年期的浮动小岛，证明这个名字真是名副其实。
I actually enjoy walking on.Trembling earth, if I admit it. It's one of these strange experiences like walking on a bowl of jelly.
Alkafunoji 沼泽区的水质酸度很高，就像浓茶一般，色调也相似。这种环境很适合食虫植物的生长，所以本地可以发现许多种类的食虫植物。这株猪笼草利用花蜜诱使昆虫进入它中空的囊状液内。昆虫一旦进入，少有逃生的机会。这些家伙被囊管上线状的透明隔窗给骗了，一直想逃出去，弄得精疲力竭。最后，昆虫掉进了管子底部，在那里被酸性消化液消化掉，然后给植物吸收了。另一个致命的吸引力则来自毛毡苔， 这种植物的叶子上有鲜艳晶亮的小珠子。对于过往的昆虫而言，这无疑是难以抗拒的香甜大餐。然而，饥饿的昆虫很快发现自己落入了陷阱，脱身似乎是不可能。毛毡苔将叶子渐渐合拢，好好享用一顿猎物大餐。在岛的边缘和许多浅的沼泽中，昆虫受不住诱惑，便会陷入这种致命的陷阱里。一切结束后，除了消化不掉的壳，几乎没有任何东西会剩下来。夜晚降临后，奥克弗诺基沼泽区在朦胧中呈现了它深邃而壮观的一面。就在1亿年前史前时代，鳄鱼的祖先在此沼泽中繁衍。据我们所知，今天鳄鱼与他们的祖先实无甚差异。鳄鱼的眼睛反射力很高，夜晚会发出灵异般的光芒。巴林和肯特针对小鳄鱼设计了一个夜间的研究计划，但是法律严格禁止在保护区内搅扰鳄鱼，即使是肯特这样的科学家都要取得特别许可才能碰他们一下。
Let's cut off the engine for a minute and get some peace. Wow, it makes a difference, doesn't it?This pole.
Beautiful. Nice and quiet without that outboard.
Sure thing. Seen any gators yet or not?
I haven't seen any in this small stretch.
I should light it light around it. Is that one over there?
Yeah, that's one back in the.
Let's try and get a bit closer to it, can we? Hold some more if you keep paddling on that side.
短吻鳄与种源相近的长吻鳄十分不同，短吻鳄很少攻击人，记录中大概只有6个人死于短吻鳄的攻击行为， 在奥克弗诺基保护区，连严重伤害的记录也不曾有过。即使如此，这些短吻鳄的危险性仍是不容忽视。被抓的小短吻鳄不停地发出哀嚎，约翰与肯特加快速度，他们希望把小鳄鱼的惊吓降到最低的程度，同时也避免惊动到可能隐藏在附近的母鳄鱼。
42.5 centimeters. 42?
What's it reading?
It's just at 200 grams.
Watch it.
Right at it. Oh, she's really cruising.
Is it the claws of the baby? Why? Look.
Yeah, the baby's just continually talking.
Well, hang on. Her jaws are open a bit, and her teeth are showing. Kent, are you sure that's okay?
I don't think it's a good idea to stay here.
You want to put the baby back or what?
Probably what I should do is just tap her on the nose and see if it scares her. They are often a little more brave at night than they are in the daytime.
Watch, she's coming, Kent.
Boy, she really concentrates on that. She just localizes right on the distress call.
I think I better push her off.
Are you sure?
She's a little too close.
This is not safe.
She's not safe?
No.
How about just putting the baby back? Don't you think that's the best idea?
Yeah, we're definitely at a disadvantage.
肯特记录了不同地区短吻鳄的生长状况。雌性短吻鳄平均可以长到7-8尺，雄性可以长到14尺，重量高达850磅。奥克弗诺基保护区里的奇观并非只限于沼泽内，譬如巴林博士在松树林的探勘工作，主要便是为了寻找红冠啄木鸟的踪影。这种鸟类已经濒临绝种，很难找到。这种鸟往往是3只以上成群住在一起，这样的鸟群称作氏族。一个氏族约需200英亩的活动范围，这种小啄木鸟身长不过7寸，却因为具有特殊的癖好而闻名。他只选择老松树作为打洞觅食的目标，还得是已经感染了红心霉菌的老松树。红心霉菌腐蚀树心，让小啄木鸟的觅食变得较轻松。一个氏族的小啄木鸟一旦发现了合宜的松树，可能会在那里待上一辈子呢。红冠啄木鸟忙碌工作，那副求生存的景象实在十分迷人。啄木鸟不断在树干上敲打出的洞，会渗出一层厚厚的松脂。松脂带着浓重的辛辣气息，是做松脂油的主要材料。啄木鸟洞巢的四周也有松脂，洞口通常在树干朝西的一面，这样太阳的热能便可以保持洞口松脂湿润又新鲜。这其中的理由，只有看到玉鼠鼠蛇之类的掠食者才得以揭晓。这种玉鼠鼠蛇爬树技巧之高，有时令人叹为观止。往往可以垂直攀爬到离地30尺高的鸟巢里。 啄木鸟巢里的幼鸟和鸟蛋看似可以轻易到手，现在松脂发挥效用了。对蛇而言，松脂是种刺激物，会把蛇弄得动弹不得，蛇必得尽量避免沾上，因此大多会惨败而退。这类危机重重的场面常常打破奥克弗诺基地区原有的宁静，掠食者常在瞬间摇身一变成为猎物。一只小短吻鳄追赶着潜在水下的大中鸶。中鸶潜到水里后暂时脱离了险境，但是两分多钟后它又不得不露出水面呼吸。 在剩下的日子里，巴林和肯特找寻着短吻鳄的巢穴。一年的这段时期，沼泽区里隐藏了许多的鳄鱼巢，想要找到这些巢穴，最佳的方法就是在雌鳄鱼回巢或出巢时跟踪它。
They should be pretty clear if they're used often, like a trail to a nest is. They're pretty obvious. This looks like one right here.
Left?
Right by these yellow flowers in this clump here. Kind of shoved the nose of the boat in here. Yeah, this is one.
You can see it flapping.
Yeah, it does looks like it's used pretty frequently too.That one looks really packed down. I think it's probably one leading to a nest.
沼泽区里交错的鳄鱼道连成了天然的交通网。早期的探勘人士经常利用它，但是有一个缺点：短吻鳄喜欢潜伏在鳄鱼道的附近，很容易会踩到鳄鱼。
It's very distinct too. I think females have been using it a lot.
筑巢的生殖季节里，雌鳄鱼的防御能力增高。它自己倒没有什么可畏惧，主要是鳄鱼蛋很脆弱，常成为以腐肉为生的动物觊觎的目标。
Wait a minute. Here's the nest. No, I think they've been eaten. Something's gotten into the nest and eaten the eggs.
Well, what are you eating?
Probably either raccoons or black bears. Black bears eat a lot of alligator nests here.
But, I mean, raccoons and bears wouldn't, what, swim and wade through this stuff?
I mean, there could be one living in this island, or he may have moved from island to island. It's hard to say if there's a black bear or a raccoon, though.Sometimes black bears will pick off the end of an egg and just eat the insides out of it. I don't know how they do it. They may just use a claw and just pop the top off and eat it.
This is like sort of an island. How does the mother make it?
I think this nest is either sunk from its own weight after she built it, or the water level of the swamp has risen some. Well, these things just scrape up all the dirt and vegetation around them.And you see there's peat in here and a lot of plant matter that holds it together. And also the rotting plant matter heats the eggs. It creates heat as it rots, and it actually keeps the eggs warmer than they would be just with the sun on them.
Could she still be around now these have been eaten?
I think she probably came back and realized it'd been disturbed and just lost interest and left.
Let's try another one then.
Okay. That's really too bad.
Yeah. 母鳄鱼通常不会离巢太远，它一旦发现侵入者，攻击性极强。巴林在拍摄一个鳄鱼巢时，曾经碰巧遇到这种场面。对巴林而言，真可说是惊险交加的场面。最后，他只有撤离，把鳄鱼巢还给他合法的主人。母鳄鱼对巢穴如此凶悍的防卫战术，对红腹龟而言极为重要。雌的红腹龟设法把蛋下在短吻鳄的巢穴里，一旦成功了，母鳄鱼将龟蛋视为自己的蛋一样尽责护卫。 这只红腹龟冒了万般的危险，侵入了鳄鱼的巢穴，下好蛋，利用了其间温暖又潮湿的环境。这只红腹龟将蛋留在巢里后，还要设法离去，和进来时一样得冒相当的危险。奥克弗诺基沼泽区内，绝大多数的成龟都有过类似的经验，而且多半不会受到伤害。短吻鳄狠狠咬了一口后，似乎便可分辨出那是龟，然后发觉红腹龟的壳不容易碎，鳄鱼也就任由它去。这只母红腹龟已经做好它分内的事，将蛋留给鳄鱼保护，毫无顾念地离开了。对水獭来说，红腹龟则是个既方便又耐用的玩物。奥克弗诺基沼泽区里面最爱玩的动物该算是水獭了。动物好玩的天性与智力有极大的关联。夏季里，狂暴的雷雨经常侵袭奥克弗诺基沼泽区，在旱季，星星之火亦足以弄得沼泽区烈焰冲天。泥煤干燥之后非常易燃，一次往往可以慢慢持续烧上数个月。火就这样烧掉奥克弗诺基沼泽里许多土地。科学家认为，类似的大火可以恢复沼泽区的生产。旱季结束，大火留下的许多坑洞就变为池塘或较大的湖。大火之后，瞬息之间地表又重现生机，奥克弗诺基沼泽区也再度荡漾着灿烂而迷人的色彩。 夏季末，鳄鱼在蛋里已经呼之欲出。这些蛋花九个礼拜才孵化出来。鳄鱼巢里阵阵哭声，引得鳄鱼妈妈迅速赶来照顾。另一方面，乌龟宝宝可能也在同一时间破壳而出了。鳄鱼宝宝的啼声相当响亮，甚至在破壳以前就能听得到。奇妙的是，这些鳄鱼宝宝的性别竟是由孵化时蛋周围的温度来决定的。如果温度在摄氏32.2度以上，生下的都是雄性；温度若保持在摄氏30.5度以下，又全是雌鳄鱼了。至于这些状况对鳄鱼存活率的影响，则至今还不十分清楚。母短吻鳄把鳄鱼宝宝衔在口里带走，红腹龟的宝宝就没这么好命了。在这场混乱中，他们只能自求多福。鳄鱼妈妈极度谨慎地将刚孵出的小鳄鱼带到水里去，一只一只地带。乌龟宝宝似乎本能就知道，在鳄鱼妈妈接近的时候，身子要放低卧倒。小红腹龟一有逃生的机会，马上不由分说朝最近的水域前进。上面的活动通通结束之后，短吻鳄和红腹龟的新生代都在奥克弗诺基展开自己的生活。1960年，在这个野生动物保留区之内的萨旺尼河上造了一座水坝，此举极可能完全改变奥克弗诺基沼泽区的面貌。这个人工水坝聚集了沼泽区内的水源，以预防附近森林地区的火灾导致林木损失。但是如此一来，很可能捣乱了火灾和沼泽之间的平衡关系。沼泽之所以有今日的风貌，正在于这更新的过程，所以专家纷纷反对水坝的新建，认为这一切所带来的冲击恐怕得要数十年之后才能看出分晓。在鳄鱼的世界里，生命循着古老的模式不断继续前行。这个阶段，小鳄鱼仍有很多天敌，非常容易受到伤害，还得受妈妈保护数个月才有自力更生的能力。鳄鱼早在有人类以前就存在于地球， 在人类丰富的知识及悉心的照料下，这些短吻鳄将会一直生生不绝，成为远古以来历久长存的生物。